Lakers Nation. Welcome to our free agency podcast. I am your host, Serena Winters, and with me again today, we've got our senior writer, Corey Hansford, joining us. And although we're not even 24 hours into NBA free agency, already big news to report on the Lakers front. And unfortunately, those reports do not involve a big free agent landing in LA, at least not yet. As most of you know, the Lakers met with LaMarcus Aldridge first thing when free agency hit, and early reports had the meeting going well, but then again, that's how it's reported most meetings go, at least initially. I know the same things were said about the Lakers' meetings with Carmelo and Dwight right afterwards, but now, reportedly, Aldridge has already crossed the Lakers off his list, and that is according to a report by Mike Bresnahan of the LA Times. In Bresnahan's report, Aldridge was not impressed with the basketball side of the presentation. He wanted a clear basketball focus, turned off by the lack of analytics. We hear there's a focus on kind of the outside opportunities of LA, but he was looking more towards the basketball side. Some other tidbits we learned about that presentation. According to ESPN's Ramona Shelburne, Aldridge asked Kobe how he perceived their dynamic would be, and he likened it to, you know, the Kobe and Pau days. So Corey, let's talk about what this means for LA. I know Lakers fans hoping for LaMarcus Aldridge, a lot of people thinking that if the Lakers got Aldridge, you know, turning a new leaf with this young talent. So what does this mean? And also, what did you think about the whole of the Lakers starting their pitch at 9:01, which I haven't seen before, with a tweet saying they were just about to meet LaMarcus Aldridge, asking Lakers fans to retweet hashtag LA to LA, as in hashtag LaMarcus Aldridge to LA, a very interesting pitch tactic.
I honestly did not mind the Lakers using Twitter and stuff like that in order to try to appeal to someone like that. To me, that's just a sign of the times. That's what guys are on these days. Maybe not Aldridge as much as some of the younger guys, but that's what people love. You see announcements, all the announcements are made on Twitter. You see Damari Carroll announced him going to the Raptors on his Instagram page. Stuff like that, appealing to that, that didn't really bother me. I know people kind of compared it to the Dwight Howard, AD12 banner and billboards and that stuff. And I don't think it was anywhere close to that. I really didn't have an issue so much with them trying to go that way because they have to pull out all of the stops. And I think they were showing that they're going to pull out all the stops for someone like LaMarcus Aldridge.
Okay, I get that. But if reports are coming out saying that he was not impressed with the basketball side, the analytics side, you know, didn't care so much for all the side of the outside opportunities for LA, then that kind of begs the question, is the organization itself failing to understand what specific things are going to convince certain specific players to thrive?
I think it's a partially, yes, the front office is probably a little bit outdated, especially as far as analytics and things like that. The Lakers are well known to not be as up-to-date as teams like the Rockets and the Mavericks and other organizations, the Spurs, as far as analytics. But I also think it's a point of what else do the Lakers have to show these other guys? If you want to talk about what you have on the basketball court, well, you're not going to measure up to what the Spurs have and what the Rockets have on the basketball court, where they have close to championship contenders or recent champions in the case of the Spurs, well-known guys who you know can perform at that championship level, whereas the Lakers can say, we've got some young guys who've never really played outside of Clarkson, and it's always questionable as far as a young guy putting up really good stats on a bad team. And so the Lakers, in a way, are almost forced to have to focus on those other things because that is where they will have the advantage. They don't have the advantage on the basketball side yet. They do need to work on their analytics and beef up that portion of the organization and really focus on those other things. But if you just go basketball side, they're not going to measure up to these other guys. And I think that's why they feel like they have to overcompensate by focusing so much on the outside opportunities that LA provides.
So the Lakers have these younger guys. They have, you know, I guess some cap space in terms of what they could offer. Do you think, yes or no, are the Lakers relying on their brand too much as a selling point?
Probably. I'd lean towards a yes. I don't have any specifics on exactly what they're all doing, but I'd say that they, and honestly most of the fans these days, still rely on we're the Lakers, this is the Lakers, you want to come here because we're the Lakers. I don't think that's just an organizational thing. I think that's an entire fan base thing as well. And it's not necessarily the smartest thing, because most players these days want to win now, and it's a what can you do for me now, and the Lakers can't really give these free agents a good answer on that.
Now, right after we heard the news of Bresnahan reporting that LaMarcus was not going to come here, ESPN's Ramona Shelburne tweeted out that the Lakers were stunned, that's what she used the quote, was stunned, to hear how coolly their presentation was received by LaMarcus Aldridge. When I read that, I thought to myself, okay, first of all, you gotta take everything with a grain of salt, right? You know, we're not in the room.
Yes.
But if that is the case, that the Lakers were stunned to hear about how the presentation supposedly went, that worries me a little bit in terms of what the Lakers think that they're presenting and how they think the meeting went, and then what the reality is. That the reality and the perception are not lining up.
Very true. And that is a worrying point, that, you know, they felt like it went really well and that they knocked it out of the park, and it wasn't that way. At the same time, that happens a lot with
sure.
in all works of life, where you make a presentation and you think you knocked it out of the park and it turns out that it didn't go as well as you thought. I think it's a wake-up call, but probably a really necessary wake-up call. Whereas last year you had, you know, with the Carmelo, probably didn't, you know, it obviously it didn't help Carmelo come, but there wasn't really a this was a terrible presentation. In fact, most of the Lakers did a really good job, and that Carmelo enjoyed the presentation. So in a way, maybe this served as a wake-up call as to, wow, we are off base here. And as the Lakers go forward in these other meetings, I don't know if they found that out before the meeting with Greg Monroe, but definitely before the meeting with DeAndre Jordan, that could be the difference in them going, okay, we need to switch something up, because clearly this isn't working with these new era of players. And so maybe they're able to switch up their style and change for the better.
So people down in the Lakers right now, and what's happening, a quote or a tidbit that we had recently read this week, Baxter Holmes of ESPN wrote a story. And in that story, he has a quote from a particular NBA executive, anonymous. And that executive says that, whether that was off the cuff, again, we did not write the story,
yes,
so we don't know exactly how it was. But he did say that an NBA executive said he fully expects James Harden to team up with Russell Westbrook and come to LA. So then I have to ask you, Corey, where do you see the next steps? What is the future? If the Lakers did not get LaMarcus Aldridge, what's next?
They're going to continue to focus on free agents. And there's still guys out there,
like
young guys,
who
can
see?
Help. Greg Monroe is still a possibility, although I wouldn't bank on it. And Tobias Harris is still out there as well, as young guys who the Lakers have reportedly had interest in. Monroe they've already met with, that could come in and grow with the young core that the Lakers already have, with Randall, with Clarkson, and with Russell. And honestly, their future is really tied to the young guys. The basketball issue is at least somewhat solved if Russell comes out and shows he's a growing star. If Randall comes out and show he's something. If not by, oh, we want to go play with these guys, then as a decent trade chip in order to get someone who is already established and a star. Unfortunately, in the NBA, you have to give up something to get something. And sometimes these young guys are better served as being chips in order to bring someone else in. And that may be the case. I wouldn't give up all of them, as what some would be reported, but one or two of them might be necessary in order to get a superstar if the Lakers can't get someone in free agency, which they're struggling to do right now.
Alrighty, Corey. Well, the Lakers have about $23 million to spend on free agents this summer. Next summer, Kobe's $25 million off the books. Salary cap grows at least $20 million because of the NBA's new TV deal.
Yep.
So there's still plenty of potential for exciting things here in LA. So make sure to keep updated on all of that and the free agency news. I know we have a free agent tracker on our website at LakersNation.com. You can go on there, see headshots of all the guys we're currently tracking, and keep up to date on that. Thanks for tuning in. You can follow myself on Twitter @SerenaWinters and Corey @TheCoreyH.